السلام عليكم. I'm Tariq Sabri, consultant intensive care, Sheikh Hostel, Fujairah, United Arab Emirates. First, I want to thank my colleagues and my friend, Professor Ahmed Had, to give me this opportunity to be with you today. Today, I'll speak about the oxygen therapy and its complications, as the oxygen is the most common drug used in the hospital. And when I say drug, I mean drug because it has effect, side effect, and it has pharmacokinetic pharmacodynamics action, as we'll explain in our presentation today. And it has also complications that we have to avoid. So today we'll discuss, give a brief hint about the oxygen therapy in our body and the oxygen dissociation care. And they will explain how the oxygen therapy using devices and how this affect on the our body. And it is used mainly for hypoxia. We'll explain what hypoxia and how the body affects on our body and how to avoid it. And then we'll explain the hyperoxia or and increase the oxygen in our body and its effect, and up to if then reach to up to oxygen toxicity. And then we'll differentiate the problems, the problem of the hyperoxemia or hyperoxia versus the hypoxemia and the hypoxia. And we can find some solution for it, or some devices can help us to avoid the hyperoxemia. So as we know, the oxygen already come to our body from the atmosphere. It will go through the airways to the lungs, and from the lung, the oxygen will be carried by the RBCs, from the iron atoms in the RBCs, to the reach to the tissue, where exchange having or delivery having of the oxygen to the tissue, and carried by, and after that they will carry the carbon dioxide and go back to the lung to be carried again by oxygen. So the oxygen in our body is carried in two ways, carried on the RBCs. This is with linked to iron atoms here, and also it is will be available on the plasma and give the oxygen tension. This extension tension or oxygen pressure represented by BO2, partial pressure of oxygen, BO2. So BO2 represents the oxygen or pressure of oxygen in our plasma, and this is very important for delivery of oxygen to our tissue, as we will explain later. The oxygen on the RBCs, it is represented by the SpO2 if we are measuring by the pulse oximeters, or this AO2 if we are measuring it by the oxygen analyzer. This is the oxygen cascade and how is the oxygen be delivered to the our body. It depends mainly on the pressure. So because oxygen go to the our tissue by diffusion, so it must be go to from higher pressure to the lower pressure. In the atmosphere, the at the sea level, almost the pressure is 150. So it will go to the our lung till they reach to the alveoli, where the pressure or PO2 around 100. Then it will go into the capillaries, and then it will reach to the tissue. Tissue below 50 is the pressure. So the oxygen can go from the higher pressure to reach up to the mitochondria, where the pressure is zero. And this cascade is very important. As well as the pressure increase, so the delivery of oxygen will increase also. So in the, and also if the pressure is less, the delivery of oxygen or to our body is less, like in high altitudes. So the oxygen content of the in our body calculated by this equation 1.34 multiplied by hemoglobin multiplied by saturation plus 0.0003 multiplied by BO2 means there is no as little effect of the BO2 or oxygen pressure on the oxygen content, but oxygen content mainly determined by hemoglobin in our body and the how much saturation of this hemoglobin by oxygen. So this is the two main factors determine the oxygen content of the body. Actually, the oxygen content in our body around 200 ml in the arterial blood, 150 ml in the per liters in the venous blood, and the total in our body around oxygen content around 812 ml in our body. The oxygen delivery, how the oxygen delivered to our body, of course, it will depend on the oxygen content that we see and the cardiac output of the our heart. So the cardiac output very important in delivery of the oxygen, and the content also, how much this system delivered to the, our tissue, it reached up to 1 liter per minute. 1 liter per minute, so it will be available to the tissue. But how much the tissue need, our body tissue needs during rest, it reads only, or the consumption, if we calculate the consumption, it will only need from 200 to 400 ml per minute. So we have around five times more available in our body in the resting condition, in the normal condition, available for us for oxygen to our tissue, which is more than enough. Again, we'll go to the oxygen distribution curve and this importance in determining how much, and it is explaining the relations between the PaO2 or oxygen pressure and the oxygen saturation, because these two important factors, there is direct relations between them. Or as we'll see here in this curve, we plotting of the hemoglobin saturations, and we plotting of the oxygen pressure or PaO2 here in the lower side. So we'll see how is the curve is come. And if you see here, it is rising with each other up to here around the 97. So after that, the curve become flat. What this means? This means after saturation 97, after saturation 97, you can't determine how much VO2, how much VO2. It will be 100, 600, even you can't know. So this is the importance of oxygen distribution curve and the relations. It is here, as we see in this slide, up to 60, up to 90 percentage saturation, almost about the PO2 will be 60. So we can expect how much the PO2 from the saturation in some cases, pathological cases, different, there is some difference in this. But roughly we can see if saturation 90, BO2 will be 60, if saturation drop to 70, BO2 will become 40. But air is 97, it can be in anywhere between 100 or more after 97% of saturation. So about 97% of saturation, you can't expect how much of the BO2. And this is very important point. But also in the other side, is it good in this oxygen distribution curve, the relation between other, because if the saturation dropped from the 100 to 90, the saturation, the VO2 is dropping to up to 60. So too much dropping of the VO2 with little drop on the saturation means we have buffer in our body, to compensate if there is low oxygenation. The oxygen therapy, we use the oxygen mainly for hypoxemia, of course, and for other pathological condition, and as we'll see. But how we are using the oxygen, what is the devices we using to enter this oxygen to our body or to our patients? So the oxygen therapy is the administration of O2 at concentration greater than the normal air temperature. Normal air concentration of oxygen, which is around 21%, with a goal of treating or preventing the symptoms and the manifestation of hypoxia. The aerobic metabolism system function using the Krebs cycle or complex serial chemical reaction that use oxygen to convert the nutrient to the CO2 and ATP. So this is the main uses for our body to oxygen, just to reach at the end, to after oxidation of the nutrients, to release or generate ATP, which is the energy to our body. So the oxygen is delivered from the either from the tap above the wall in your hostel or from cylinder, it is delivered, it is, the flow is around 100% concentration. Then it is then both through the different devices with different rates to adjust the oxygen concentration that is the patient inspire according to the flow and according to the device. It will determine how much concentration the patient is using. The percent of oxygen inspired depend on the flow rate and the delivery devices. So the flow rate can be set at the wall tab. It is very, of course, the flow meter on the our hostel between 0 and 15 liters per minute. The delivery devices work with different flow rates and which include the nasal cannula. So the nasal cannula, it can deliver from 24 to 40% of oxygen, and the flow rate usually from 1 to 4 or 5 liters per minute. Because above 4 liters per minute, this flow will dry the nose and can cause a crustation and can cause problem. So we said this is around maximum 40% oxygen you can give to the cannula if you the flow reach up to 5 liters per minute. It's used, of course, for the patient with mild hypoxia or mild desaturations up to 92. If less than the 92, you need more devices to give more oxygen. The common devices we are using, this is the simple face mask. Simple face mask can deliver from 30 to 50% of oxygen according to the flow rate you bought. Flow rate usually from 5 to 10 liters per minute. The most important devices is non-rebreathing mask, and we have used during the COVID era also. So the but these devices can give up to 90% of oxygen if you are using about 15 liter flow rate. The bag or the mask, it was with valve that stopping almost all the rebreathing of the expired air. As we saw here, there is valve here above the bag. So this is valve one way, so they prevent the exhalation air to go with mixed with oxygen. So the oxygen will go in higher concentration, and this is the idea. This is how is this mask is working and to reach to up to 90% of oxygen. We use the for the patient with severe hypoxia, and we need high concentration of oxygen, and he can tolerate the non-invasive. The other device is the oxygen tent. It is more comfortable for the patients. The air is changing and the oxygen changing maybe 15 times, 12 to 15 times per minute. So deliver around 14% of oxygen if there is as 10 to 15 liter per minute. Venturi mask, which is a very important one and considered one of the high flow devices. The idea of the Venturi is that if the gas passing here by high flow rates, it will create negative atmosphere here. This is negativity can pulling more air enter here, so the flow will be high. The flow will be high, and also we can determine how much the oxygen of concentration. We are using different colors, and every color indicating how much the FiO2 or oxygen concentration is going to the patient. As we see in this figure, you see here, which is written on every color, we have from blue line. The blue line, it is, can give 24% if you put the flow around 2 liters per minute. The white, 28%, or you have to put the flow also 4 liters per minute. The orange can give 31%, you have to put the flow on 6 liters per minute. And the yellow gives 35% if the flow around 8 liters per minute, the red 40% on 10 liter, and the green is 60% on 15 liter per minute. The high flow cannula also, this is very important, and we are using heavily in the critical care, and we used heavily during the pandemics of COVID. It is working by the, we are giving a high flow, there is here oxygen, the flow of the oxygen coming here, so it will go to the oxygen blender, and after that humidifier here, there is humidifier and adjusting the temperature, and it will go to the patient. Actually, it is high flow air with oxygen. The high flow air with oxygen, this is the adequate description of this. So the oxygen supply system capable of delivering up to 100% of humidified and heated oxygen at the flow rate up to reach up to 60 liter per minute. All the settings are controlled independently, allowing for the greater confidence on the delivery of the supplemental oxygen as well as better outcome if used in addition to the general control over the delivery. And we adjusting the flow of the from maybe starting with 15 liter per minute up to 60 according to the patient tolerability and the required and pathology of the patient. Temperature we are adjusting from 30 up to 34 in this machine. If the patient tolerates 34 is better. And it actually is very beneficial in giving the patient comfortable and good oxygenation. It is used mainly in patients with hypoxemia, but you have to be cautious if used with patients with CO2 retention because it may increase the CO2 retention. It is good because it improves the cellular action and clearing of the secretions and give good oxygenation for the patient. This is the device that makes the oxygen. Here it is mixing here, and after that it is going with the humidification to the patient. The non-invasive ventilation, this is also important device to give oxygen for the patient by the mask, tight mask or tent here as we use helmet here, or we can use the mask, different mask. There is nasal mask, face mask, full face mask. So there is different devices. We are using with the ventilator, of course, our CPAP or BiPAP machine. We use to move the CPAP continuous positive airway pressure, and that will give fixed pressure during inhalation and exhalation, or BiPAP mode, which give the pressure during inhalation and there is pressure during exhalation, which is more comfortable for the patient. Also the invasive ventilations, this is for 100% oxygenation of the patient, the critically ill patient, and you can't depress it, so you have to put in mechanical ventilation or sedation, used of course endotracheal intubation, or if the patient has tracheostomized or he needs tracheostomy, this is all called invasive ventilation or 100% oxygen. It can reach to the patient, you can adjust how much FiO2 you need from maybe 21 up to the 100% oxygen by setting of the ventilator. Other devices who are using oxygen in the treatment, this is a hyperbaric or the high pressure chamber to give hyperbaric oxygen and high pressure. As you said, if you give high pressure, you will give more oxygen to the body. We are targeting the BO2 to reach 400 for short time, only maybe 30 minutes, and they give high FiO2 100%. So in give frequent session of the body, it is using for treatment of many diseases, as we'll show later. So we are using oxygen mainly for hypoxemia. We are using oxygen for hypoxemia mainly. So what is the hypoxia and any difference between hypoxia and hypoxemia? Yes, hypoxia is in medicine, it is a condition of the body in which the tissue are starving for oxygen. So in extreme form, where the oxygen is not entirely absent in the condition is anoxia. So on the level of the tissue, there is no oxygenation or oxygenation is low called hypoxia. No oxygen at all is called anoxia. But when the oxygen decreases in the body, in the blood, it's called hypoxemia. And it's the same for the hyperoxia and the hyperoxemia also. If the oxygenation increases the level of the tissue, it is called hyperoxia. In the blood, it is called hyperoxemia, but for the ease, we'll use the term hypoxia and hyperoxia to be ease for you. So as we know, if the how the hypoxia is happening, so according to the all steps of supplying oxygen to our body, starting from the atmosphere, if the pressure in the or concentration in the inspired air is low, it will cause hypoxia. And any problem in the airway, it will cause hypoxia like foreign body or any obstructions or narrowing in the airway like in the bronchial asthma. So it will cause hypoxia. So on the level of the lung, if there is any pneumonia, any problems in the perfusions or diffusion of oxygen, or pulmonary edema, it will cause hypoxia. If we go to the levels of the blood, if the hemoglobin is low, it will cause hypoxia. Cardiac output is low, or there is congestive heart failure or stagnation, it will cause hypoxia. And the level of the tissue, if there is any poisoning, can prevent the tissue from using oxygen, like in cyanide poisoning, so it will cause hypoxia. So all this is all the cause of the hypoxia, and this is all the causes for to give oxygen for the patient. But any device, but in, by any devices like this mask to the ventilators. So the hypoxia, we have four types of hypoxia, and of course hypoxemic hypoxia. If the oxygen pressure in the blood is going to the tissue is too low and to saturate the hemoglobin, so it's called in this time hypoxemic hypoxia, and there is anemic type or anemic hypoxia. If there is the hemoglobin is low, so the amount or content of oxygen will be low. Stagnant hypoxia or stagnant type, if there is heart failure or problem in the cardiac output or hypotension for any cause, is called stagnant hypoxia. And histotoxic hypoxia, if the on the level of the tissue, as we mentioned, by toxicity or some medication can decrease the usage of the oxygen by the tissue, like bleomycin. And how is the hypoxic conditions or any pathological hypoxia, as we said, if any trauma or osteoporosis, the patient can't breathe. If any respiratory disease, as we mentioned, pneumonia, interstitial lung disease, etc. If the unstable angina, so the cardiac output will be low and the some problem in the oxygenation on the blood flow, and multiple organ failure, can cause hypoxia. Cancer can cause hypoxia, congestive heart failure, and heart attacks, any hemorrhagic shock, any peripheral arterial disease, all affecting the perfusion of the tissue and cause hypoxemia. So the hypoxia is harmful. It affects all the system of the body. So it can cause pulmonary vasoconstriction, and this is will be increased to the ventilation of the body and cause respiratory alkalosis, and also can cause pulmonary hypertension, chronic, and in the cause systemic vasodilatation initially. So the blood pressures will increase initially, and this reflects of sympathetic activation. Heart rate will increase, patient cardiac output will increase, myocardial concentration velocity and myocardial concentration also contraction, sorry, it will increase. This is initially, but it's failing, it will cause hypoperfusion. This is the same like hypoperfusion of the organ. So it can cause to the field of the organ of the brain, it will cause the symptoms and like stroke in the heart. It can cause the symptoms like myocardial infarction and low cardiac output. In the kidney, it can cause acute kidney injury and renal failure. So according to the organs, it will cause the same symptoms like hypoperfusion. Type hyperbaric oxygen, it's used for the treatment of hypoxic tissue in some disease. And it because the effect of the hyperbaric oxygen, as we said, we reach to the VO2 up to 400. So it caused the oxygenation of the ischemic tissue and the hypoxic tissue. So increase the plasma and the tissue oxygenation tension 10 times, which helps the tissue to maintain the tissue viability without RBCs. And also it is caused the neutrophil oxidative killing effect. So it can cause the decreased infection. It causes suppression of the multiplication of the bacteria also, so can cause infection like in diabetic foot and etc. It also augmentations of the antibiotics effectiveness, enhances the fibroblast function, and it causes angiogenesis and the formation of the new blood vessels, so enhancing the healing of different disease. There is many indications for this, but some approved, some not approved. It is working with hyperbaric oxygen, like Alzheimer's disease, traumatic brain injury, OTIS, post-traumatic stress disorders, many indications is there, but there is some confirmed and some not confirmed. So this is the indication. What is the complications of oxygen therapy? It is the hyperoxia and oxygen toxicity. So the oxygen therapy, as we said, it is using 21% administration, concentration greater than room air. So for hyperoxia is the state of the excessive supply of the O2 in the tissue and organs. It develops in the continuous exposure to the sobra physiologic concentration of oxygen, and it can lead to oxygen toxicity. So the oxygen toxicity is a condition resulting from the harmful effect of oxygen therapy, or pressing of molecular oxygen increased the partial pressure. It is an effect of the prolonged hyperoxia, mostly associated with long-term oxygen therapy or the hyperbaric oxygen therapy. The oxygen, like any other medication, also has its side effect. There is three factors very important to cause this hyperoxia and oxygen toxicity: the pressure, the time of exposure, and the oxygen concentration. So the pressure, the normal normobaric hyperoxia, it will hyperbaric hyperoxia. The time is important because if you use FiO2 more than 60% longer than 36 hours, it will cause hyperoxia and oxygen toxicity. Also, if oxygen concentration more than 80% longer than 24 hours, it can cause oxygen toxicity. Usage of the FiO2 more 100% longer than 12 hours, it can cause toxicity. And of course, the oxygen concentration, FiO2. So we are targeting all the time to use FiO2 below 60%. The high risk group, as we mentioned, from these three factors, the pressure, concentrations, and the duration, of course, long-term ventilation with high concentration of oxygen usage, those with high concentration of supplemental oxygen for long duration, if 100% more than 8 to 12 hours, as we mentioned, infant and neonates, also high risk for oxygen toxicity, premature baby, patient on mechanical ventilation, and exposure to the high level of oxygen more than 60%, exposed to the chemicals that increase the risk of the oxygen toxicity, like chemotherapeutic agents like bleomycin, and undergoing the hyperbaric oxygen therapy. So how is this oxygen toxicity causing harm for the body? It is by causing, or it is forming what's called reactive oxygen species, like the superoxide anions and hydroxide radical, hydrogen peroxide, and hypercalorous acid. This is the free radicals or reactive oxygen species. It will affect all the types of the cells or all particles in the cell. It will affect the membrane. It's called lipid peroxidation of the membrane, affects the mitochondria and cause mitochondrial damage. It can affect also the DNA and oxidized DNA, breakdown of the DNA. So affects all the parts of the cell. So in the cell, it is the constitute the organ. So of course, it will affect all our organs in the body, starting from the head till the toe. So it can cause chemical toxicity to the tracheobronchial tree and capillary endothelium, alveolar epithelium, cause to pulmonary damage and atelectasis and hypoxemia and acidosis and this. So you treat the patient from the pulmonary problem or the hypoxia, but this hyperoxia can cause damage to the lung, and also it causes damage to the retina, and also cause erythrocyte hemolysis, can cause myocardial damage, can cause renal damage, renal failure, hepatic also affect, because as we said, it destroys all parts of the cell, can cause chemical toxicity, destruction of any cell, and can cause this endocrine effect also. It is an effect on the end adrenal and gonads and thyroid. Toxic effect on the enzymes and the cells of central nervous system, so it's causing twitching, convulsions, this desaturation of the neurons up to brain death. So what is the symptoms and signs the patients will show? So your patient is there, but he has symptoms and signs, and you can't explain, like the patients have seizure, but you couldn't find what is the cause of seizure, maybe due to hyperoxia. On the eyes, the patient can go through visual field loss or nearsightedness, or the patient can have cataract or bleeding or fibrosis in his eyes. For muscles also, can muscle twitches, and you can't explain, the patient is there and you can't explain unless you are aware by the hyperoxia and oxygen toxicity. Respiratory also, it can cause shortness of breathing, irritation, coughing, pain, shortness of breath, tracheobronchitis, acute respiratory distress syndrome, even. So the oxygen has double edged sword. So it is a friend or foe. It is an enemy for us or friend for us, can help us. It has the two aspects, and depend on your usage and your wisdom in usage of this drug, as we see. So we have problem here, because when this observational study done on the patient and they do permissive hyperoxemia in the study, the effect, they found that the hyperoxemia can increase the mortality or the harmful for the patient, the same like hypoxia. So the both hypoxia is harmful and hyperoxia is harmful. Also, in this big review of the patients, they review many studies, and including or around maybe 14,000, more than 14,000 patients. They found that even hyperoxia can increase the all outcome, the hospital outcome or hospital deaths. So the hyperoxia can cause this maybe even more than hypoxia. In this review study also, they reviewed 24 studies and including more than 17,000 patients, they found that the arterial hypoxia is associated with poor hospital outcome. So that we know hypoxia is bad, but also hyperoxia is bad, as we see the oxygen toxicity. So what is the solution? Maybe some devices can help us. Yes, there is devices used the oxygen reserve index, as we mentioned. Here in the the problem is in the pulse oximeter, you can't, as we said, you can't expect how much after 97, how much the BO2 of the patient can be, something between 100 or more than that. So there is a problem here. Also, there is limitation for pulse oximetry for the patient, and the many fallacies can come. So, and the only way to determine hyperoxia is to measure the BO2 or oxygen tension in the blood by oxygen analyzer. But oxygen analyzer also has a problem. It is an invasive, it is intermittent, and it is delayed and is associated with the blood loss or rapid oxygenation change may be noticed. So there is a problem also for oxygen analyzer. So we need something to be live, real time, and all the time monitoring of our patient. They used the oxygen reserve index tool, and it can determine you when the patient in the stage starting for hyperoxia of the patient, and the according to the area from mild hyperoxia or the severe hyperoxia for the patient, or the patient is normal oxia. It can measure BO2 or the suspected BO2 between the 100 and 200. And it will tell you when, which stage of the patient, and it will be lifetime monitor, can adding to your monitor like this. It will be something between 0 and 1, and the 0 below 0, the patient, this is saturation of BO2 below 100. If more than 1 means the more than 200 BO2, so you can determine early the hyperoxia of the patient and prevent it. Finally, the take-home message. Both acute hypoxia and hyperoxia causes harm for the patient. The recommended hyperoxia during surgery or the beneficial, it is not broad that the oxygen can hyperoxia during surgery help with the healing. The optimal O2 range for individual is dependent on the specific clinical situation and the comorbidities. The oxygen reserve index might help to better titrate the FiO2 and thus to avoid both hypoxia and hyperoxia. Finally, this is my reference, and thank you.